The word Tawhid does not mean simply one God, but it means unity in life. It also means unity in universe, which is also called cosmos. Universe, as we observe, functions perhaps due to certain push and pull created by gravity. But who is keeping this gravity? Why certain satellites, why certain stars, and why certain Milky Way and others are at certain distance from each other? Why not a collision? Why a system in the universe? Is sun and moon following a sequence, or they are independent? Does it ever happen that in winter sun may decide, I'll take a break and will rise up after 2 hours of morning hour? Or moon not following the same cycle, which means that sun and moon have willingly or unwillingly, as the Quran says, submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they are following the map, the chart made for them, which means that universe has a uniformity, a unity. It does not have more than one principles on which it's operating. Therefore, Tawhid is not confined to human unity and behavior, but Tawhid also envelops the existence of unity in cosmos. And consequently, it demands that if universe is having a uniformity, and if human life should have a uniformity, then society should also have uniformity. Society should not have conflicting ideologies taking people apart, on the other hand, trying to bring them together. Therefore, when we talk about unity in life, or first principle of Tawhid, then it means that whatever we are going to do, that should be synchronized, that should not have opposite feelings working at the same time. When I work as a dentist, as a medical doctor, and my main purpose is to mint money and not to serve those who are in pain and distress, which happens to be the Hippocratic faith oath taken at some time and many other oaths taken by medical doctors, then it means at that point in time you don't have one God, but you have two gods. A God of your money, which you want to mint from your patients, and a God who will be saluted on Friday or some other fixed timings. Now, when you have these duality, these two aspects, then Tawhid is not implemented in life. But if Tawhid is implemented in life, then whether a person is doing a profession, a person is working as a factory worker, or a person is working as an administrator, in all those cases, this should be the final determining principle. If a worker on assembly line in a factory has made a commitment with the organization that he will have an output of 25,000 units produced in 2 days, and he is working lazily on the assembly line, then he is not following Tawhid, because he is betraying the commitment he made. Therefore, Tawhid's application is not only in masjid, but it's a principle that inspires ethical behavior and conduct of human beings. Any question on that? Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. Second primary value is what the Quran calls adl, or equity. And that means creating not only balance but creating beauty. When you have everything in a nice proportion, you call that body beautiful. If you have nose of Pinocchio and ears of Donald Duck or Mickey Mouse, you don't call that person beautiful. Therefore, adl as balance and moderation is not confined to the literal meaning of legal justice. But adl means that moderation, that balance which results into beauty. Therefore, when the Quran says, O you who believe, do adl and ihsan with those who are near relations, then it's not telling us that if your cousin or your parents or your children have done one good to you, you do one good to them. That's tit for tat. But saying adl, which means if a father or mother is given a gift by their son or daughter, then they don't have to just return the same amount. They can make it 10 times more when they return. That's what is doing it with beauty, with adl, with ihsan. So adl or equity, justice, fairness, you see, adl cannot be translated in one single word. It has so many dimensions which cannot be covered by the word justice. Justice often means what is done by way of an equal treatment. But adl does not mean equality. Unfortunately, from our early childhood till we become mature and think we are good teachers, scholars, professors, we understand by adl that justice which is based on equality. No doubt all human beings are one and same. But you cannot have a person who is having a taste for architecture and art and a person who is a cook or a cobbler placed at same level, although as human beings they are same. Their capabilities, their skills, their talent makes them different. Consequently, if you expect from a person who is a laborer building a highway and a person who is dealing with intellectual highways, a scholar who is developing models, theories and coming up with production of knowledge, you cannot say they are both equal. Therefore, the so-called concept of equality, which is applied quite often in the case of men and women, and people feel that they are discovering something very valuable and new by saying that women and men are equal, do not act justly. They don't take approach of adl. Approach of adl means that if a female deserves 10 times more than a male, then she must get it. Yes?
Sir, I have a question. What I understood by justice was that it is an equal return. Mm-hmm. In the case of adl, it is something that you do out of proportion. It can be double than what you received. Sir, in the case of relationships and giving gifts and what example you gave, I understood justice and adl. But in the case of professional life,
I am supposed to come and attend a seminar where I am supposed to present a paper, the program has been prepared at least 6 months ahead of the seminar, printed distributed to all participants, which says that Mr. X is on a panel that will be having 10 minutes each, and at the end 20 minutes for question answer session for the whole panel. And I, as a senior person compared to others who are youngsters, begin my presentation and make it 20 minutes, and people are all absorbed in that. It is injustice. Although I am giving something very important as a top scientist of the world, and those who are youngsters waiting besides for their presentation, although feeling very bad inside, but will never say, "Sir, you took our time." Yes, so we learned a lot, thank you very much. That is not adl, it is injustice. However, if I use my 10 minute slot in which I have given only 20% of the content, time is utilized equally, but the content, the quality of content, the expectation from me is not met, it is again zulm. Although I have taken no more time from them, I was expected to do my homework and come up with all those aspects of that topic given to me. When you come to your classroom and you have these slides prepared, and they are same slides which were prepared for PGD 3 years back, then for you who are newcomers, you don't know what was done 3 years back, but for me, it's injustice. I must update, I must revise. Therefore, justice does not mean equality, does not mean simply a fixed or a solid state, but justice is a fluid state where in each case you are going to determine what is better and suitable, appropriate. That's why we say justice means what is fair. Fair does not mean it is fair to give a person 20 rupees and not 50, or it is unfair to give 50 but fair to give 20. You cannot have fair straitjacketed. You cannot have fair defined in empirical terms. This is fair and no more fair. Therefore, ethical judgment is not like a positive judgment of a physicist who will be measuring, weighing and telling you this is the length of this microwave wave numerically by translating it into numericals, although you cannot see it, but he measures that. You have measurement for light, measurement for everything. But how can you do that with ethical judgment? You see, our concern in this whole semester is how ethical issues are to be handled, understood, how values are to be translated, how norms are to be observed. Norms and values are not a matter of what I like or you like. Otherwise, these will be local norms. But if norms are given by a divine source, which is above human finitude, above human limited reason, above human concept of history and time, then whatever standards are given are going to be applicable for maybe a century from now. You don't have to change that. You may change those norms which you make in Toba Tek Singh for Toba Tek Singh. But if norms are given to Toba Tek Singh by someone who was giving same norms to people in Lagos and people in Perth, then it is universal, it's applicable. Therefore, adl is not simply a matter of equality, nor a matter of mathematical justice, but a matter of what needs to be done has been done. When you are stitching after a surgery, then how many stitches and what kind of stitches? Dissolvable or non-dissolvable? How tight? You want to break the tissue by making it more tight, or you want to join the tissues by giving it a proper tension? That proper tension is adl. And that proper tension means you are an experienced surgeon. Or else, making a knot for stitches is no problem. Even a cobbler can do it. Cobbler makes those knots every day. But his knot and knot of a surgeon has to be different. If we ask a cobbler to make knots, is it justice? Although knot is made from same thread. But only when the surgeon has made that knot with that much distance which is required and no single micromillimeter less or more, then you say. But with the second patient, he may not do it. The second patient may have a body texture which is different. If he applies same measurement for this person, it's zulm, not adl. Therefore, justice is not something very simple. We can reduce that in one single word. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Please, please. You see, adl means putting a thing in its proper place. This is how the definition exists in our legal literature. In books that deal with Islamic jurisprudence, adl is defined as placing a thing where it belongs. Okay? For example, if I start breathing from my ears, ultimately the system joins somewhere here. Your ENT system is not separate completely. But suppose I train my body and block my nose and create a passage inside somewhere in membranes, so I start breathing from my ears. It will be a remarkable thing done by me. People say, look, what an expert, yoga expert. But is my ear designed for that purpose? Am I doing it because breathing belongs to this area or this area? Do I have same kind of membranes that function in this part of my sinus, where you have certain very soft tissues that absorb some dust, that emit some moisture, that keep my system working and does not freeze there? Do I have same? Is the antibacterial element created in my ears same as in nose? When I am doing it, the whole system is being challenged and changed by me. Not justice at all. But when I take care of my nose with ihsan, that means I wash my nose at least 5 times a day with fresh water, then my membranes here get fresh touch, dust is removed, allergy is minimized, then I am using it in a proper manner. Now, ihsan means doing things with beauty. The root word is hasana. He seen noon. So when it is said ihsan, then means you are doing something in a beautiful manner. It is very good to make a French salad with very crisp vegetables and present to a friend. But if you also put on it French dressing with olive oil, or Thousand Islands, or whatever you like, then you are doing it with Ihsan. It's same salad, but you are adding. But if that salad is not just put in a bowl, mixed up together, but you find the lower level mixed together, then a level of carrots and one of tomato and one of whatever you want to put in that, and ultimately in the middle, a flour made from a carrot or from a radish, then you further enjoy the salad.
So that means that everything should be done with Ihsan?
Sure. That's what Islam wants. The meaning of taqwa is not long shirt and prayer hat. The meaning of taqwa, the root word is waqaya, which means doing things in most perfect manner. Itqan means perfection. Itqan, the word means that when you are doing things in the most perfect manner. So when you are praying in the way as suppose we prayed, when you are respecting your parents the way to be respected, when you are loving your kids the way to be loved, when you respect your wife the way you are supposed to respect her and not treat her as a servant in your home, then you have taqwa.
So then while dealing with others, we should have the attitude of Ihsan. But while receiving relationships, receiving attitudes from others, we should have the concept of Ihsan in mind? Or we should, you know, just they should be just touching the baseline when they give us some attitude? Once we get used to Ihsan, doing it, you know,
in a very beautifying way, whenever someone does something for us, then we expect in the same way. And then at that time, we say that you should not be expecting that much, you should just, baseline should be met when someone is doing something. You know, perhaps in the back of your mind, you are taking the word Ihsan in Urdu. I am talking Ihsan in the Quran. Ihsan in Urdu means that if some friend has brought a gift for me, then I return the same gift with added value to the person and not less than what has been received by me. This is what Urdu Ihsan means. But Ihsan in the Quran means that even if you are offering, as a hadith says, that even if you gift hoofs of a goat, which people throw with sincerity, then it's a beautiful gift. That means it's not just the price tag. I'm not aware of any society where hoofs of goat or cow will be given even a penny. The people throw it and don't care about it. But hadith says, even if you are giving hoofs of a goat to a friend, then it is a gift. But gift with love and respect. If you study cross-cultural situation, you will find that quite often a Japanese will give you a gift wrapped in more decent manner than the gift itself. That means it's not value of the gift, but the way you present. So Ihsan is not a matter of favor, not a matter of returning something with something more added to it. It could be even something less valuable, but with more respect and love and compassion, then it becomes more valuable. So unfortunately, we have become so much materialistic in our life because of our so-called Eastern and Western cultures, where superficiality, showing off, is considered as better than a person who is very simple and not imposing. So people try to behave in same manner and imitate all those customs and cultures which are there in the East or the West, and we end up in a superficial society where people have no sincerity, no cohesiveness, no love, no understanding for others. So the concept of adl is not just a matter of equality or legal justice, but it is much, much wider, of fairness, of doing things in a certain manner. And that's why, since these basic concepts are never clarified, never shared, never put in the minds of kids when they are just 3 or 4 years, then we grow a selfish, self-centered, egocentric people who always look for protocols, benefits and perks and never think what is our responsibility. Ethics means responsible action. What should I do at this time? How should I do at this time? Why should I do it at this time? All these questions are to be asked, and only then ethical behavior will come out naturally without any kind of artificiality. Okay, next value, I think I have to go quickly on it. I cannot afford to have so much details on each point. These points will be elaborated later on when we discuss further details of what is ethics in Islamic framework. Next value, which is very much which is primary and universal, is protection and promotion of life. Life in the Quran is called nafs, ruh, and one's existence, and both terms are interchangeable. We also say nafsi, nafsi, selfishness. So the Quran says, do not kill your nafs unnecessarily. And that means, or says, killing one nafs is killing the whole of humanity. That means life protection and promotion, two very simple words. Protection means that all those aspects that harm our life on this planet are unethical. Therefore, if you provide sharp knives with razor edge to children who are hardly 3 years old to play, then you are harming their life. And same when you provide them with a cartoon network for 6 hours, you harm their life. We never realize that. Then what's promotion? Promotion means that when you are providing conducive environment, if you have 75 people in this room and no single exhaust, your body heat, number of people multiplied, will make your life difficult. And quite often a person who has cold sitting next to you, you will catch cold from him. But if you have necessary space between people, exhaust system is there, air circulation is there, fresh air is coming, you have less chance of catching cold. Then it means you are promoting life. If you allow your kid to buy a motorbike and in the evening put on its silencer an additional vibrator, and he goes out doing all kind of noise pollution, then are you promoting life? Or every single wagon not wagon, but Mercedes Benz of people who think they are very rich, leaving fumes, clouds of fumes, then are you promoting life? If you are selling milk, which is not milk, but made from chemicals, are you promoting life? If you are putting a taxation on people, which is beyond their limits, are you promoting life? The principle appears confined to simply killing or not killing.
But it is not confined.
This is the beauty of Islamic thought. If you understand it, if you absorb it, internalize it, then you discover that every single term has enormous applications. And that's why I use the word primary universal values. This is not a value which is a result of Arabian mind, not a value result of Persian mind, not a value because of African mind, but it is a value given by the Creator Himself. Therefore, it's universal and it has application. Now, can we say that protection of life in 2017 is very good, but the same principle becomes obsolete in 2025? Then we have liberty to kill anyone. Can we say that the principle of promotion of life, that you must allow only those policies which promote life, is applicable in 2017, but since we will have more population in 2025, it will be not applicable, you can kill people as you want? Is it logical, rational, acceptable? Therefore, Islamic values are universal. They are not local, Arabian, imposed on non-Arab people. These were given to Arabs to change themselves. So its first target was to change Arabs into Muslims and then to generate a society, a community of global Muslim community with those values. And therefore, this is a primary value, and that also means all those aspects which you teach, contraceptives, all those procedures which are terminal. Terminal procedures mean which cannot be reversed. All those processes which do not allow promotion of life and protection of life are against this principle. You have to think and rethink on your textbooks, on your teaching material, on what you are doing in your classes of physiology and anatomy, or later on mother care and so on and so forth, what you call that. All those aspects are based on this single principle given by the Quran, that do not kill but promote and protect human life. This applies to your genetic engineering, this applies to your termination of conception, this applies to your all those aspects where surgery and other areas are left free. And that's why you find that even in societies which we regard as very permissive and very liberal and very open, even there you find that this birth control issue becomes an election issue in North America and elsewhere. And political parties who are otherwise extremely liberal cannot take positions other than what they believe. Okay, then next value is protection of reason or aql, that only those actions should be performed which ultimately lead to promotion of a rational attitude and which are based on a reason. You cannot take an erratic approach about life. You cannot be simply guided by emotions, but you have to take an approach where reason is applied. Again, this principle tells you very clearly that what you are told and millions of people are told from their childhood, that religious matters are emotional matters, don't touch people on those issues, there is no place for reason and logic in religion, does not apply on Islam, may apply on some other religions. It may apply on religions which are founded on dogma. Dogma means that faith which cannot be touched and analyzed, which is just given and period. For example, when you believe in Trinity and you say there is God, Holy Spirit and Jesus, peace be upon him, and say I believe in one God, how do we reconcile rationally? Three in one, yet you say one. That is a dogma. How it becomes one? What's the proportion? Is God 30%, 25%, 45%? What's Jesus' percentage? What's the percentage of Holy Ghost? No one can ask and no one can answer. In Latin, it's called scandalum. Scandalum means scandal in English. But it's a theological term which means that it is something beyond human reason, and therefore we cannot touch it, we cannot talk about it, but we have to accept it. That's what dogma. We have no dogma at all. The value of reason means everything has to be rationally, logically questioned, analyzed. Therefore, Islam happens to be the only faith in the family of all world religions where reason and rationality is part of Quranic teaching. The Quran again and again says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. Don't you find you are people of thinking and... So this is how the phenomena is. If you just permit me for... So the idea is that Islam does not take that approach which has been adopted by many other world religions. Then the next value is preservation of religio-cultural freedom. That means wherever Islamic state is established, it is going to provide full liberty of practice of religion and culture of divergent people, people of different nature. It is totally incorrect to think that if an ideal Islamic state is established, then it will have no Christians, no Hindus, no Jews, no atheists. Islamic state is essentially a state with plurality of cultures, but an ideological state. And we'll not deal with that right now. That will be dealt when we talk in our second semester on Islamic thought and civilization. We have a whole section on political thought. Here the point is that it's a primary value, and therefore religious rights of people are to be fully observed. Then protection and dignity of the gene and genealogy, that genes should not be allowed to mix, that family tree should not be confused, should be identified, that human beings should not be anonymous. This is a value. And consequently, in any society where Islamic ethics is applied, we cannot allow anonymity of coming generation. Every child must be identified with parentage. You cannot have banks of frozen sperms available taken from the Nobel Prize winners. So you have your children who are Nobel Prize winners. It's not commercialization of gene. Therefore, the principle is that human dignity of gene and the lineage or genealogy has to be protected. You should not be allowed to mix. And that's why Islam does not permit extramarital relations between two sexes. Lastly, protection of property, which means that it's a value that you should not steal, you should not usurp, you should not misuse property of others, and that also includes intellectual property, not just property in terms of wealth or material existence. I'm sorry, I took quite a bit of time for only one slide, and that is perhaps my weakness. Now, what was said in first part of first slide, which was on Tawhid, you find in this Quranic reference that say, do you serve instead of Allah that which has no power either to harm or benefit you, whereas Allah alone is all-hearing, all-knowing? That means Tawhid is to be realized as a primary value at personal level, in personal life. And unless it is done so, then we are not observing Tawhid, but claiming belief in Tawhid. So the ayah says, do not call upon any apart from Allah, upon those who have no power to benefit or hurt you. Its impact on governance. Tawhid means there is no sovereignty but of Allah. People in Britain call the sovereign, who may be a queen or king, as the ultimate arbiter, decider for everything. So they have sovereignty of king. Many Muslim countries have kingdoms where king is declared as sovereign. The Quran says only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sovereign. Therefore, political power, authority belongs to only Allah. And if this is violated, then we have no tawheed at political level in that country. Although you may have the so-called sacred places of Makkah and Medina, but if you have kingdom there, then you have sovereignty of other than Allah. It's not Allah's sovereignty there. It's not Islamic State. Islamic State means only Allah as sovereign. Tawhid, translation in law. So the Quran says, those who fornicate, whether female or male, flog each one of them 100 lashes, and let not tenderness for them deter you from what pertains to Allah's deen. It's Allah's deen that this act should not be committed. And if someone has committed that, then this is the boundary of Allah, and their love and compassion for them should not frustrate you, stop you from implementing the punishment. Otherwise, deen is not established. Therefore, deen is not what we think, prayer and worship and religion. Similarly, in financial matters, those who believe, do not eat a property among yourselves in vanities, but let them be amongst your trading by mutual good and will. So have trade and business, but not that you exploit and usurp amount of others which belongs to them. Tawhid financial matters, so the Quran says, whatever is left of your earlier transactions of interest, leave those. And if you do not want to change that, you want to get interest or pay interest, then be prepared to face a war against you from Allah and His Messenger. Nowhere else the Quran has used more strong words than against those who indulge themselves in interest or usury, or who take loans and give loans on interest, like our normal banking system. So the Quran says very clearly, those who are doing it, they are inviting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet to wage a war against them, and that means to execute them. Similarly, Tawheed in administrative justice, which means that when we are deciding matters, what grade to be given to a student, A or B or B plus or A minus, then it has to be based on Tawheed, not on cronyism, not on the student always flatters you and says, sir, you are best teacher, I love you very much, you are so kind, you are so knowledgeable, and that flattery makes you compelled to give A grade to a student. So Tawheed in administrative justice in all matters, we are human beings and we are all subject to that. And similarly, Allah exhorts that we should observe Adl and Ihsan. The word Ihsan appears here, which was asked earlier. And by the way, this is the ayah which is part of Jumu'ah Khutbah globally. Surah Nahl. In Rayam Adl wa Ihsan with Azhar Qurba. This is the ayah which is recited by every khatib all over the world in Jumu'ah to remind that you Muslims be just. You Muslims have beautiful way of doing things, but we never hear, and if we hear, we never understand. If we understand, we never apply. What a pity. Huh? But that's how it is. Anyhow, I'm sorry for sometimes very blunt comments, but we don't mind that. Okay. So, this is in administrative justice. Then, what does this term Adl means? We said earlier that it's one of the core teachings of Islam. It's also a major attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, the sustainer. It is a desirable behavioral quality to be reflected in the attitude of all believers and in their behavior towards their Rabb, toward universe, toward their own self and others. Are we doing Adl to our own selves when, by listening to a TV talk or reading a book, we start losing weight, starving and becoming a skeleton? Because that may give me more longer life. Or having seen a sumo wrestler on the screen, we start eating and become like him. Is that Adl to ourselves? Similarly, is there Adl towards universe when we are emitting carbon dioxide from every air conditioner, from every car, from every refrigerator, from every factory, nuclear waste, dumping that in oceans, destroying all life in oceans, and you find that Allah has put larger resource for us in oceans than on earth. Ocean is also a source for food. You have weeds, you have fish, you have all kinds of sea creatures. But we never realize that. So, are we doing justice toward universe or towards our own selves and people around us when you are shouting in your class on a student, do you do justice to your own self and to your student? Losing temper. Ji?
Increasing the population is also unnecessary. The population
hourly. Ji, aapne jo do alfaz istemal farmaye hain, in pe zara sa gaur karne ki zarurat hai. Ek to aapne farmaya ke izafa, increase in population, abadi mein. Aur ek aapne farmaya ke necessarily or unnecessarily. Is cheez ka faisla ke zameen pe kitni paidawar 2017 mein paayi jati hai aur paayi ja sakti hai 2025 tak kisko karna chahiye. Is cheez ka faisla ke ek insaan jo ek khandan ke andar hai wo apne khandan mein izafa kare ya na kare, ye faisla kisko karna chahiye. Is cheez ka faisla ke jo is waqt zaraye paaye jaate hain, kya yahi zaraye wo hain jinhe qiyamah tak rehna chahiye, ye aur koi zaraya nahi ho sakta. Ye wo sawalat hain jo kisi ha ya na mein nahi ho sakte. Main wapas jata hu jo zuban hamari lecture ki hai usi ke andar. When we decide is it appropriate, correct or unnecessary or necessary, there should be an authority to decide about it. Suppose I am that authority and I decide that I should not have more than one child. While Allah and His Prophet says that do not kill life and let life grow and expand. Am I justified in my decision? Take the other extreme. My wife is diagnosed some problem by a specialist and they tell she should not have more than 3 or 4 conceptions. And I say no, since the Prophet liked larger family, so I must have 12 kids. Is that following Prophet and this ayah? Who is judge? Let's translate the issue into population, into food material. Suppose one square meter of a land produces 80 kilograms of corn, which people in a village consume. And we say in the village you have around 2000 people. Now we anticipate with the same birth rate, in next 5 years we'll have 4000 people and same produce, which means we are allowing increase at one point, but here we have frozen the production. If we use brain, which you never do, then we should find out how we can have jumbo corns created by perhaps a GM intervention. You have now the concept of genetic modification, and that started with food material, now it is in human beings, but the origin was in vegetation. Now in that again we shall have to find out, when we do that modification, then is it going to provide same nutrition, or you have multiplicity in size and quantity but creating cancerous problems in body. By eliminating all those aspects, we can have organic food development in a way that when population is 4 times more, even then they get the food. Then alternate food thinking. I have this 1 square kilometer, why shouldn't I make a portion of it for fish farming and have fish farming there and get more healthy food than corn? If we only use brain, then all those superficial issues which were introduced by Malthus in 19th century, that if population increases, then you will have a scarcity of resources. And that's what we had taken as a belief. There are 1,000 ways of letting population grow, because that provides you manpower, strength, at the same time providing for them necessary skills, training, healthcare, without begging to United Nations or IMF or World Bank for any help. We only need to use our brain power, which Allah wants. When we said aql, aql is a value, we say no, we'll never use aql, we'll follow blindly what Britain was doing and now what America is doing. These two gods, earlier god was British, now American god. Then we will end up in mess if we do that. But if we only use our brain power, then both issues of population and others can be very easily resolved. There is no reason at all to cut down on population in this country and anywhere else. Resources can be increased, multiplied to unimaginable limits, which we are not doing. Try to find out in a so-called grocery store in New York or in Australia, on the stacks, how many brands of cereals are for the people and how many brands of food are for dogs and cats. You will find no less than same space covered with the variety of dog food and cat food. But if we were observing the biological cycle of replenishing things and then the natural cycle, then your waste in your home will be going to be recycled biologically by people around. You peel your carrots and apples and whatever and potatoes, and you give that to your goat, to your cow, to your horse, and that generates again through a biomedical process milk and what not, and then again it's recycled. A whole process has been frozen by our artificiality of life, and that creates more chemical waste than anything else. If you only collect 1 week's empty cans of Coke and Pepsi in North America, you can make a wall from Philadelphia to San Francisco. This is figures quoted on net which I have seen. Very good. Yeah. Tell us your wisdom.
उनके बदले में प्रॉपर 5 درخت लगाए जाते हैं तो 4-5 साल के बाद ना ये बड़े हो जाते हैं फिर इसी तरीके से ये काटते जाते हैं और पीछे से
जी बिल्कुल
सही आप काटते जाएंगे और आपकी वो नहीं होगी ग्रोइंग नहीं होगी
जी
ये तो होगा अल्टीमेटली इसलिए
देखिए ऐसा है कि इस्लाम वांट्स अस टू हैव सिटी प्लानिंग दैट मींस when a population reaches a point, then after a certain distance, a new locality must grow and develop. So you have natural beauty, you have everything. Unfortunately, we have no regulating authorities either in villages nor in towns. You find in towns, wherever people want, they stretch their land, occupy, make constructions, and then pay some fine, and that's all. Same in villages, where people have no concept of keeping distance, keeping nature clean. That means it's not a matter of population, but a matter of educating them, giving them a culture, advising them for certain things, training them in areas where things can be done in a better way. Unless we do that, even if you control population, it will make no difference. People will have same kind of rubbish thrown wherever they want and pollute the whole environment. What we need is their education and training. In that situation, population will be a helpful factor for us. We need manpower for development. Anyhow, so Adil refers to all these areas. Okay. In other words, if you want to summarize the meaning of the term, it's balance and harmony, impartiality, equity and justice, no discrimination, fair and just social conduct, with ethical, moral and legal responsibility. In that sense, Adl becomes an applied ethical principle. An applied ethical principle, which means it's not just a matter of theory. It's not a matter of sermon. We often think Islamic issues are given in sermons and have no practical application. But here you find the Adl, if properly understood, is applied principle that covers enormous areas. Social implication of Adl. Islam visualizes the individual self in the context of family. Living family life is considered an ethical obligation and a social responsibility. So the hadith tells us that your nafs has a right on you. Similarly, nikah is declared a sunnah and the requirement for completion of iman, and celibacy and monkhood are condemned, and the state and society are asked to let people live a family life. So the Quran says, and marry off every single person among you. Economic dimension of Adl, it covers areas which are just summarized here for you. Right to economic activity, that everyone has a birthright to participate in economic adventures, coming up as entrepreneur, doing things the way one wants. Secondly, everyone has right to save and invest. Whatever is utilized for one's living, beyond that one can save and invest in whatever the way he wants, and naturally without involvement in any kind of riba or interest. Right to transfer, distribute and gift, therefore a person can gift his property or whatever he has to anyone he likes. Right to inherit, that keeps the property in circulation. Right to share or sharaka or mudaraba, labor and contracts and work agreements. right to just economic reward, that whatever a person is doing, a fair compensation must be provided, and ultimately dignity of labor, that no work is mean. The Prophet, peace be upon him, himself does not mind lighting fire for his wife for cooking, does not mind cleaning floor, does not mind stitching his clothes. No work of labor is lower or less category. All aspects of work are recognized and dignified by Islam. Impact of other political order, holding of independent views and opinion, that every believer has a right to express his or her opinion on various issues. Assuming public responsibility, that means there is no group of people, clergy or ulama or people of religious nature, who alone can become rulers. No. Khilafa, Imara, Niaba, Imama, all terms used are public responsibilities, and anyone who qualifies for that can enjoy their authority. Then decision making, trying to come up with consensus view on issues by debating, formation of group or jama'ah or congregation, you can make an organization a party. Then to fight for truth, for justice and virtue, for public good, and to take steps for administrative elimination of injustice, falsehood, corruption and obscenity. Summarize in just two terms, Amar bil Maruf, that means when we establish virtue, good and welfare, and Nahi anil Munkar, when we eliminate injustice, falsehood and corruption. These are political dimensions of this term Adil. In the domain of religion and culture, liberty to interpret the Quran and Sunnah within the Muslim Ummah. There is no single group of people who enjoy immunity or who have the authority to interpret. Everyone who develops the capacity to understand the Quran and Sunnah has liberty to interpret the Quran. Right to practice one's faith and culture as a non-Muslim, and then use of principle of ijtihad as a requirement, which means that a medical doctor, an engineer, a pharmacist is obliged by his or her faith to be innovative. Ijtihad means not a matter of some mufti in Char Sadda to give a fatwa, but mufti in laboratory who is a pharmacist, mufti in a OT who is doing surgery, mufti in a business center who is having on his laptop transactions with people in China and Netherlands. What should you do? What should be done in all these cases? That means ijtihad. If things are not defined by the Quran and Sunnah, and you take an action in those areas based on Quran and Sunnah, then you are mujtahid. Should you terminate pregnancy or not? Should you go at that point to a madrasa or a masjid and ask a maulana? Or you have to be the mujtahid. That means you must know that much of Islam which allows you to make a judgment at that point, a juncture in life of a person which cannot be delayed for an hour and 2 hours, so people go and ask someone. No, you are the mujtahid. You have to decide. When in your classroom someone raises a question dealing with security, you should be able to answer that from Islamic viewpoint. You are mujtahid. You cannot say, well, I was a graduate of Harvard, they never told me Sharia, so I cannot. You go to Mufti Sahib to ask. No. Don't teach then. If you want to teach, then fulfill obligations. You are not obliged to teach. Yes? Ji ji. Wa alaikum assalam.
जी के हवाले से पॉइंट में कि अभी हमारे दरमियान भी काफी इस तरह की बात होती है कि जैसे मुफ्ती तकी इस्माइल साहब फरमाते हैं कि सिर्फ जो आवाज है ना सिर्फ कुछ खसूसी उलमा ही दे सकते हैं
जी
उलमा नहीं दे सकते कुरान कर सकते तो इसके बारे में जरा क्लैरिटी चाहती हूं कि मेरा ख्याल है कि जब अल्लाह ताला ने फरमाया है कि तुम में से हर एक जो है
देखिए इसके बारे में मेरे कहने की ज़रूरत कोई भी नहीं है। अगर अल्लाह ताला ने आपको खलीफा बनाया है तो किस बात के लिए खलीफा बनाया है? महज ऑब्ज़र्व करने के लिए, काम करने के लिए? अल्लाह ताला ने इंसान को खलीफा इसलिए बनाया है कि वो अल्लाह ताला के नाइब के तौर पर काम करेगा। नंबर दो, अल्लाह ताला ने जो आप पर ज़िम्मेदारी आयद की है अम्र बिलमारूफ नहीं मुनकर की, वो क्या सिर्फ़ दारुल उलूम के पढ़े हुए अफराद पर आयद की है या यूनिवर्सिटी के अफराद पर आयद की है या हर एक पर आयद की है? गोया हर मुसलमान को मारूफ का हुक्म देने का जब कहा जा रहा है तो उसको ये भी करना होगा कि मालूम करे कि मारूफ क्या है और कहना भी होगा। जब अलैहि वसल्लम ये बात फरमाते हैं कि बल्लिगो अन्नी वलौ आया, तो क्या इसका मतलब ये है कि जो मुफ्तियान कराम पाए जाते हैं वो सिर्फ एक आयत जानते हैं या और भी कुछ जानते हैं? और जो मैं एक आयत जानता है वो क्या करे? हदीस का मतलब ये है कि जो एक आयत जानता है वो भी विड्रॉ नहीं करेगा, आगे बढ़ेगा, बयान करेगा, बताएगा। तो इसमें कोई आपको मुझसे पूछने की ज़रूरत नहीं है। मैं तो बार बार ये बात कहता हूँ कि बजाय अफराद से मालूम करने के आपको चाहिए कि आप कुरान और हदीस को ख़ुद खोल के देखें और पूछे कि हम क्या करें, और जब आपको वहाँ से मिलेगा बरह रास्त।
सर इसमें एक चीज़ शेयर करूँगा
जी।
एक आलिम से मैंने पूछा एक मसला रिगार्डिंग कोर्ट कचहरी, तो उसने मुझे बताया कि ये चीज़ आप प्रॉपरली सारा लिखें और एक एनवेलप पे डाल के दारुल फतावा इस एड्रेस पे
जी जी जी
टाउन में
जी जी जी।
फिर मैंने उसे पूछा कि वहाँ क्या होगा, कहते वहाँ पर मुख्तलिफ मुफ्ती कराम बैठे होते हैं, किसी का कोर्ट एंड बैंकिंग में इंटर्नशिप एक्सपीरियंस होता है, वो सारी बारीकियों को समझते हैं, होते आलिम मौलवी हैं, किसी का दूसरे कारोबार और बिजनेस में होता है, किसी के डॉक्टर्स के साथ हॉस्पिटल्स। तो आपकी जो भी वो शोबे से ज़िंदगी हाई शोबे से उस बात का ताल्लुक होगा, तो वो मौलवी जो जिसकी उस सिलसिले उस शोबे की बारीकियों को समझता है तो उसके बारे में उसके कमेंट्स रिमार्क्स शरिया से लिख के फिर आपको वो फतवा इन रिटर्न आपको वापस भेज देगा। तो ये वो कह रहा था कि बहुत ज़्यादा अल्ट्रा रिफाइन तरीका है आपकी जो बात पूछने का। तो मैंने कहा तो यह तो बहुत सिंपल है, आप खुद भी कहते हैं नहीं ऐसे नहीं, एक तरीक़ेकार वज़ा किया गया है
फिर जी जी
जो आपको बिल्कुल सुपीरियर ओपिनियन इस्लाम के पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से, अगर कोई गायनी एंड ऑप्स डिपार्टमेंट में काम कर रहा है उससे कोई गलती हो गई है तो वो अपने ऊपर अपने वो जो अंदर से एक फील होती है कि मेरे ऊपर ये एलिगेशन आई है मुझे किसी ने देखा नहीं है लेकिन रब के हाँ मैं क्लियर हो जाऊँ, तो वो करता कि इस तरीके से आप वो फतवा
ان ریٹرن وہ آپ کو مل جائے گا تو وہ زیادہ بہتر طریقہ ہے بجائے کہ آپ کو ہر مولوی صاحب یا ان سے پوچھیں یا
جی جی
پڑھ کے
جی
بارے میں ڈسائڈ کریں.
عربی بہت ڈائیورس لینگویج ہے, قرآن پاک سارا عربی میں, ہمیں عربی آتی نہیں, ہم ہمیشہ اس کا اردو ترجمہ کرتے ہیں, تو اس اردو ترجمے کی وجہ سے شاید یہ جو اختلافات آ جاتے ہیں اس اردو ترجمے کی وجہ سے آئی تھنک آتے ہیں. اگر ہم عربی لینگویج سمجھ لیں اور وہاں سے اپنی لینا چاہیں نا گائیڈنس, تو پھر ہمارے لیے بڑی آسانیاں ہوتی ہیں.
آپ کی بات کسی حد تک درست ہے, مکمل درست نہیں ہے, کیونکہ قرآن کریم جو ہے وہ خود اپنے آپ کو بیان کرتا ہے. اللہ تعالیٰ یہ فرماتے ہیں کہ بیان کرنا ہمارے اوپر ہے, ہم بیان کریں گے, ہم بتائیں گے کیا مطلب ہے. اور اس میں یہ ضروری نہیں ہے کہ آدمی عربی میں پی ایچ ڈی کرنے کے بعد ہی غور فرمائے. اور اگر کوئی ترجمہ ایسا ہے جو عربی سے قریب ترین ہے, وہ ترجمہ بھی بہت سے مواقع پر بہت کافی ہے بات کو سمجھنے کے لیے. جو اصل ایشو ہے وہ یہ کہ شوڈ اے گروپ آف پیپل ہو آر کالڈ اسپیشلسٹ ان اسلامک اسٹڈیز اور کالڈ مفتی بی آسک فار ایوری تھنگ, اور شوڈ اے پروفیشنل ہیو بیسک کیپیسٹی ٹو ڈیفرینشیٹ بٹوین واٹ از حلال اینڈ حرام اینڈ واٹ از پریفریبل. دا اسلامک پوزیشن ایز آئی سی ان دا قرآن اینڈ سننا از ویری کلیئر. آئی ایم اکاؤنٹیبل فار دیٹ مچ وچ آئی نو, ود ان دیٹ مچ وچ آئی نو if I act responsibly I do not have to ask anyone. Hadith says your heart is your mufti, which means you ask your heart that I am a GP, but as a GP the patient I am examining has this problem which does not require a micro specialist of only one nostril nor the other nostril. If I know that much which is needed, I should act. I should not say you go to the expert of right nostril then you can get a medication. However, if there is a complex issue, then you don't need just one doctor but a medical board. Tell me, in every hospital, don't we have an early morning assembly of experts who sit together and look into what they are going to do surgeries today and what are problems there? I, as a non-medical doctor, know all these things. So, where you need to consult a specialist, go and do it. But if you are a GP and you know certain issues that you can handle very easily, then why you have to send to a mufti? No need at all. That is cumbersome, unfair to the patient. So in your question, I believe that in areas where the Quran and Sunnah are evident, there is no need to ask anyone. Just ask your own heart, am I fair or I am exploiting the Quran and Hadith for myself, misusing. If we depend on our heart and its purity, then definitely we will be guided rightly by the Quran and Sunnah, and you will never deceive yourself or deceive others. So the point here was that there is no clergy, no specific class, yet there can always be teachers who know more than students. Always be guides who can help them, but no guide and no teacher except the Prophet peace be upon him is immune from error. Biggest mufti can make a big error, not a small error. Therefore we should not take people as authority, but we should take the Quran and prophetic sunnah as the authority. And at the same time, if there is need for some very specialized area, then definitely help should be taken from others. Now here are references for the pyramid that you saw earlier, value of life. So the Quran says, do not kill any person. Allah has forbidden to kill except with right. And then on that account, we ordained for Jinnah Israel that if anyone slew a person, then killing the whole of humanity. Then value of family tree and prohibition from killing fetus and children in the ayah is given very clearly. Value of reason. So you find the Quran telling us that you should not indulge in liquor which covers your reason and does not allow you to act independently based on your reason. Then right of religious and cultural freedom, coexistence and plurality of society, and no compulsion in Islam. And the value of ownership. Therefore the Quran says, do not eat up or consume the property of others or mix up with yours. And that takes care of this morning's discourse. Any questions from the points? Koi aapke tajaweez is jo hamara ye module hai ethics ka, इसको ज़्यादा बेहतर बनाने के लिए किस तरह आप लोग ज़्यादा इन्वॉल्व हो सकते हैं? मकसद यहाँ पे कोई खुतबा देना नहीं है, बल्कि मकसद ये है कि आप लोग इन्वॉल्व हों, इस पे सोचें और मुझे बताएं कि ये जो हमारे मसाइल हैं इनका हल कोई नहीं हो सकता या हो सकता? द पर्पज़ इज़ नॉट टू गिव यू अ लेक्चर. आई एम नॉट अ लेक्चरर. आई एम हेयर एज योर कोलीग टू expose you to issues. These are the issues, and we need to find out how new issues can be discovered and these issues can be resolved. So this is the main purpose of this whole PGD. It's not a class in the normal sense of a class. G.
Sir, it's for other, make it a little more, like you said, that we should be all responding to
G.
So can we do it like something like a case-based?
Definitely. Definitely. If you have seen my course outline, then it gives you all liberty, and from the textbooks that are recommended, you can go over them and based on that, make a case study in your own area where you feel more comfortable. Present that in the class, discuss it here. It's very welcome idea. That's what we want ourselves. I don't want to lecture at all. I want to hear from you on those issues, but I believe that we should have some common ground to have a dialogue. For that dialogue, I bring some information. So based on that, we can interact and exchange our views. This is the main purpose. Otherwise, if you open the Quran, you will find all those ayat yourself. I'm not discovering anything new for you. I'm just bringing what I believe is relevant to this topic and inviting you to bring some more material from the Quran and Sunnah which is relevant, and I may have missed that. So the purpose is to having an ongoing discussion and dialogue among faculty members, which is anyhow an objective of university. University means where teachers are producing knowledge, interacting continuously, not confining themselves to their micro subject, thinking that, well, I'm electrical engineer, I'll teach only electrical engineering, nothing more. No. Ji.
Sir, humne kabhi Quran ko padhne aur usko samajhne ki koshish hi nahi ki. Bahut mushkil mushkil kitabe jo hum log pad rahe hain.
Ji ji.
Lekin kabhi humne aajkal bahut easy tafaseer aa chuke hain. Matlab tarjume mein Quran aap padhe to usme koi cheez aisi mushkil nahi jo aapko samajhna hai. Lekin humne kabhi koshish hi nahi ki.
Ji.
Sabse achhi baat hai, main jis baat ko aap bada achha unhone tarjuma kiya hai, Tawhid sahab ne, wo color mein
जी जी
वो बड़ा हेल्पफुल है मुझे वो उसका एप्स भी है इस बार प्लान वगैरह
जी 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 एक साहब नॉन प्रोफेशनल हैं कनाशफाक नाम है उनका हमारे वाले नहीं उनका भी नाम है तो उन्होंने एक पूरी किताब लिखी है जिसमें ये बताया है कोई 400 सफ़े की किताब है जिसमें ये बताया है कि जितने भी अल्फाज उर्दू में पाए जाते हैं वो सब के सब कुरान करीम से माखूज़ हैं जिसका मतलब यह है कि उन अल्फाज को गौर से कभी पढ़ लें उर्दू वाले अल्फाजी को तो कुरान का बड़ा हिस्सा समझ आएगा। हमारा मसला ये कि आपके बच्चे ख़ास तौर पर और शायद आप भी बजाय उर्दू के एक नई नस्ल जिसका नाम है रोमनाइज उर्दू जो मैं नहीं पढ़ सकता आई कैन नॉट रीड अ सिंगल वर्ड ऑफ रोमनाइज उर्दू आई कैन रीड उर्दू रस्मुल ख़त वेरी फास्ट और इंग्लिश वेरी फास्ट बट नॉट उर्दू रिटन इन रोमन दिस इम्पॉसिबल फॉर मी टू रीड इम्पॉसिबल दैट मीन्स आफ्टर टू जनरेशन ऑल दैट लिटरेचर ऑफ तफसीर शेर अदब स्टोरीज हिस्ट्री Nothing can be read by your coming generations. This is a very simple strategy of shaitan.
Sir, जैसे कीनिया में स्वाहिली ज़बान जो है,
जी जी जी,
वो अरबी,
जी हाँ जी,
और
जी जी,
60%
जी जी,
लेकिन वो लिखते हैं,
जी,
ये इंग्लिश में,
जी,
तो वो,
लेकिन वो लिखते अब है, पहले नहीं थी वो,
अच्छा जैसे
ओरिजिनली वो नहीं थी ओरिजिनल रस्म ख़त अरबी था
हाँ
ये था मलेशियन का ओरिजिनल रस्म ख़त अरबी था वहाँ भी उन्होंने चेंज किया तुर्की में चेंज किया एवरीवेयर इट हैज़ बीन एन प्लान्ड एक्टिविटी टू कट यू फ्रॉम योर हेरिटेज ताकि दो नस्लों के बाद आप कुछ पढ़ नहीं सकते सिरे से
सोमालिया की जुबान को अगर आप देखें तो 90% अरबी आपको
जी जी जी
70% इसी तरीके से युगेंडा की आपको 50% अरबी लगेगी लेकिन वो रस्म ख़त उन्होंने ऐसे कर दिया कि आप बंदा समझते कि ये मेरी
जी जी बिल्कुल ऐसा ही है वो आपसे किया जा रहा है और आप उस पर खुश हैं राजी हैं
खमसीन वो 50 को कहते हैं अरबी में भी
जी हाँ वही कहते हैं कोई सवाल इस मौजू के ऊपर
जी क्वेश्चन At your boss decisions, is it in other?
जी साइलेंस का मतलब दो हो सकते हैं एक तो ये है कि आप एग्री कर रहे हैं दूसरे ये कि आप उसको इंडोर्स भी कर रहे हैं साथ में इस्लाम मुतारबा ये करता है कि आप वही चीज़ इंडोर्स करें जो सही हो अगर कुछ गलत है तो उस पर आपका आवाज़ उठाना आपका फरीज़ा है जब हदीस में यह आता है कि अगर तुम कोई गलत काम होते हुए देखो तो उसको अपने हाथ से रोको उसको ज़बान से रोको या उसके बारे में ये सोचो कि ये लाजमन गलत है तो दिस गिव्स अस प्रायोरिटाइजेशन ऑफ बिहेवियर It does not say that just in your heart feel very bad about it and keep on burning but never open your mouth and never use resources. If in your classroom no principal, no dean, no vice chancellor, no manager of the campus is intruding and you are authority, And you cannot deliver what you want to deliver. Who is responsible? Therefore, people should understand priority. First thing is to use your strength of physical strength needed or resources needed, tools needed. Second is speech. At least protest against it and say it's wrong. But to say something is wrong has 1,000 variations. If you listen to your senior doing something, you say, sir, you look to be very ignorant in saying that. Other possibility is, sir, what you are saying is perhaps right, but I recently went through a research paper which says so and so. Can we further think about it? It depends how you are going to communicate. Some people have a tendency to begin with anger and show that this is a proof of iman. It's not. Iman means when you are doing things in most appropriate manner. Therefore, mu'izah hasana, da'wah bil hikmah. These are the words of the Quran. Invite people towards the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with wisdom and very appropriate polite word. So there is no room for keeping silent. Definitely one should express disagreement in polite words, and if needed in a loud manner. The Quran says that lady whose right has been denied is permitted to raise her voice, although Allah does not like raising voice. But she has right. And it's a lady who has given this right to all humanity. Because of her problem, Allah said, no, this lady has right to protest and shout. That means it was a problem dealing with a female, but that problem led the Quran to allow that right to whole of humanity. Now it's no more only for women, but for everyone. Ji.
Sir, but when that, suppose that person says something out loud when they undergo a problem, but the rest of the community, the rest of the group tells them that, hey, you should have done sabr. This is not... Ji. That person feels guilty, then why do we even raise our voice? So, what should be the ideal thing?
You see, this is a misuse of the word sabr. Sabr in Arabic does not mean to surrender or withdraw. But sabr means that when a person is strongly keeping his or her position. So the Quran says you should be constant in doing things, which is sabr, not withdrawing or not submitting. In Urdu we have meaning of sabr, which is of surrender and withdrawal. But Arabic term sabr means istiqama, persistence, continuously striving for that. That is the meaning of sabr. Sabr also in the Quran means jihad. Therefore in Surah Anfal, ayah number 67, the Quran says, if you have only 20 sabirun, they will overcome 200 unbelievers. Sabirun, sabr karne wale. So the term sabr is misunderstood when we go for its Urdu meaning. But in the Quran, sabr is not keeping silent, withdrawal, but doing jihad, actively persisting on your position. جی
مسلم کی ایک حدیث ہے جس کا مفہوم ہے کہ اپنی مسلمان بھائی کی مدد کرو پاؤ وہ ظالم ہو یا
جی جی
تو فرمایا کہ مظلوم ہونے کی صورت میں اس کی مدد کر لوں اے اللہ کے نبی ظالم ہونے کی صورت میں اس کیسی مدد کرو تو فرمایا کہ اس کو ظلم سے روکو یہی اس کی مدد ہے
جی جی انصر اخاکم ظالما او مظلوم. These are the wordings of hadith, that help your brother whether he is zalim or mazloom. And the question was asked, how do we help a zalim? Mazloom can be understood. And the answer was that to stop zalim from zulm is helping him. Which means we cannot be silent observers, but we have to be proactive, all the time coming forward and doing things. not looking for people, what will they say? Okay? Ji. دیکھیے صبر کا مطلب جو آپ نے بات فرمائی ہے ان دیٹ اٹس ویری سمپل اے پرسن ہو از افیکٹڈ بائی اے شاکنگ فینومینا Having sabr means that one should be able to control or manage one's emotions. Management of emotions is the meaning of sabr. It is not a matter of letting tears fall down or not having a feeling of grief. When Prophet's son passes away, then tears come out. And someone says, even the Prophet cries, he said, it's human, human. And therefore, crying or expressing one's grief does not violate sabr. But sabr means when we are managing our emotions, not going beyond. In other words, when people in lamenting or trying to show their grief, beat their bodies up, tear their dress, that is going beyond sabr. So in that situation, sabr means there are limits and ways of expressing your grief and shock. Do that, nothing wrong in that, but not to go beyond that.